So we move now to Simon Vector. Are you here? Hi, Simon. Thanks for being here today. Okay, just a short introduction because Simon, that is a German artist, became popular for a performance last year using smartphone and Google Maps. But he had all his activity is a large part of your activity and your art is related to the maps and how the maps are related with the real world. So I give you the floor for your speech, Simon, please.
Yes, thank you very much for your introduction. Thank you for having me. I'm gonna try to share my screen as well. Right. So yes, hello everyone. I'm Simon Record. I'm a media artist. I would say based in Berlin, but actually I'm working in different locations. And you know, basically in cyberspace and so on, there is no physical location in a way. So that's actually the place where I feel familiar, where you know, where I have a lot of communities. I'm also part of the CCC, which is the so-called Chaos Computer Club. That's I think like let's call it like a group of hackers, and you know, they are trying to prove systems, technical systems, and well, you know, of course they are kind of very, very deep involved into programming. And well, I studied art at the University of Art in Berlin, and there I went to the so-called digital class, and we learned I think programming in the end, and basically programming as a way to express our art. So you know, people, or let's say artists, they learn how to paint or how to draw a painting and to express their art with this kind of method. And basically we are using, or I use, much more technology and digital tools to work with and to express my art. And basically for me, when I talk about this, most of the time I see my art as some kind of journalism, because I mean, right now here at this conference, I guess, you know, we are somehow also in a way in a bubble, or let's say in a group of people which are, let's say, super highly into new technologies. And, you know, basically, I think we are quite familiar with this. But I think we should never forget that there are a lot of people out there which are basically super unfamiliar with new technologies, with digitality and, you know, things like social media and so on. And for them, it's really just a tool. And I think for me as an artist, it's super important to tell stories or to create narratives that basically, well, shows a bit like a view behind the curtain, or basically a view inside of the black box, and make the people better to understand like how these systems are working, and also how they shape our everyday life, and in the end, how they shape society. And I think that's a really crucial part in my artworks, like how technology is basically shaping society, and then raising the questions and how far we'd like to go with it. And this is my webpage, just quickly a few projects. You know, I'm kind of working with different materials and different styles. It's not like this that I'm just working with maps, but I had the time where I was really interested into it, especially maps from a historical point of view, and then basically analyzing, trying to understand how maps have been changed over time. Like maps, you know, had been defined back in the days by the military or by the state, and you know, they used it as an instrument of power, or let's say as an instrument of argue, to you know, divide countries, to divide people, and so on. And basically since, yeah, I think 2001, there had been like a paradigm change with the upcoming of digital maps, like the one from Google Maps, for example. And I guess like today, when you ask somebody, think about the map, like especially young people, but I think a lot of people in general, they think about digital maps. And I think the first thing which comes in their mind is a digital map like the one from Google Maps. And I think this changed a lot, like how we deal with them on the one hand, but also how this technology is shaping our everyday life. So there is this sentence by Marshall McLuhan where he's saying, like, at first we shape our tools and then they shape us. And then that's basically like one sentence. I truly believe in it in a way, like how the technology basically is also shaping the way how we, let's say, for example, move in the city from A to B, or how we move in the environment we are living in. So, and today I would like to show you two projects because, you know, we are talking about maps, and as already mentioned, I did the project, it's called Google Maps Hacks, and I did that last year in 2020. And yeah, again, what I did there was I just used 99 smartphones, basically Android smartphones, and I put them into a little hand red wagon and carry these smartphones in the wagon behind me in the street. I mean, basically here what you see is a friend of mine. I was behind the camera, so don't. Basically what happened then after a while when you do this is that you will realize that after a while the streets on Google Maps will turn red. And that means that Google is detecting virtual traffic on the street. But in fact, there is basically just a guy with 99 smartphones and a little hand wagon and basically walking alongside the street up and down. And well, I got this idea when I went to a 1st of May demonstration in Berlin, which takes place basically every year. And in this time, I had to look at my smartphone and I realized that that Google was basically showing virtual traffic on Google Maps. But in fact, there was no car outside the street. Basically, there just had been a lot of people with their smartphones walking alongside the street. So I was thinking, okay, would it be possible to recreate something similar? And then it was quite clear to me that I don't need the people. What it needs is basically their people's smartphones. So, and this was basically that's it. So just put, or basically just take smartphones into a hand wagon, and then you can recreate this, or you can create virtual traffic. And well, this project, I think, shows quite well, like, how maps as some kind of, let's say, data visualization, or let's say, well, basically like a surface where data appears, can shape our, let's say, way how we move in the city, and can also somehow be, you know, used as a instrument of power as well. And well, what happened here was, for example, that, for example, we did a virtual traffic on a bridge, and then after a while, we literally realized that the street was getting more and more empty by cars. And this was really interesting to see, like, how we are related to these tools like Google navigation systems, especially in city centers like in Berlin, you know, where you have taxi drivers or tourists. They're using these tools. And of course, they had been getting rerouted around us. And after a while, the street was empty. So I think that this shows quite in a let's say, in a novel way, like how Google, you know, can be used also in a way to, yeah, in a way to manipulate us, how we move in the city. And I published this project 1 week before the 15th birthday of Google Maps. And I wanted to make journalists aware of, or basically it was quite clear that a lot of, you know, journalists, they will write about the 15th birthday and how this, you know, tool has changed our life and how we move and so on. But I also wanted to make those journalists aware of, like, you know, what's basically the downside of it, and, you know, how these maps can also be used, let's say, against us in a way. And because, you know, the thing is, and that's also important to mention here, is that, like, when we have digital maps, I think one of the big, let's say, narratives they tell is that it's going to be a real-time map, you know, because when we have printed maps and books, in the moment when they are printed, they're already outdated, right? Because the surrounding around us is basically changing over time, right? We have rivers, we have whatever, we have streets that are being built new and so on. And with digital maps, or basically Google, what they're saying is, like, look, we have like a real-time map. It's basically fed by data. And you are not just using these maps as a user of the navigation system, you're also providing it once you're using it with your data and basically shaping this map as well. And well, that's basically also, I think, one big, let's say, different when you compare real-time maps with analog printf maps. And the third part of the project I also wanted to show was that, well, basically, I think it was in 2015, Google, they announced that they're going to open their Google headquarters in Berlin. And there had been a lot of, let's say, protests against the building because people were afraid of that, you know, once the huge company arrives there, the prices in the neighborhood will grow. And, you know, basically this kind of gentrification will go on and, you know, food is getting more expensive and so on. And then they basically canceled the plan to open it in that part of Berlin. But they slowly and silently moved to another part of the city, mainly more in the city center of Berlin. And they opened their headquarters there, but without any publicity or, you know, that somebody was basically, you know, writing or reporting about that. And even now, if you are now standing in front of that building, you will not realize that this is the Google headquarters of Berlin. There's nothing written outside of it. There's no symbol, no icon. Even, you know, basically it's just like on the door, a little icon, which says like, yeah, Google, and there you can ring the bell there. And I also wanted to make basically the people aware of, yeah, look, actually Google arrived here. This is where they are. And it's just a question of time when other big players will arrive as well. And also raising the question of what does it make with the city, what does it do with the city. And here I think I use the map or this performance with the map to tell the story as well and to show that to make basically people aware of that. And well, the thing is that, you know, Google's maps or Google Maps have we need to know that there are different, let's say, versions of it, and or let's say different Google Maps APIs or versions. And for example, there is like there's Google Maps whatever Germany or Italy, or there's Google Maps India or Pakistan or US and so on. And what I did in this project here, which is called Google Maps Borders, was that I was interested in if Google is showing us the same information with regards where you're coming from, and especially with regards to the Google Maps borders between the countries. So I wrote a little algorithm which basically scanned all the borders around the globe with the different views of the countries. And what I found was that Google is drawing the borders differently with regards where you're coming from. So for example, here, what you see on the left side is Google Maps China. And on the right side, you see Google Maps India. And you can definitely see that the borders here are different drawn. And of course, it's a political decision in a sense. Also interesting here is that Google is also not showing the river on the left side, but on the right side. And basically, there are a lot of examples like where you can see that how Google is here making somehow like decisions, I think more like with regards to the local opinion of the country and not taking, let's say, a neutral position in that sense. Also here, I think a pretty famous or maybe a narrative is that Google Maps Russia on the left side, you see the Krim Island. We all remember the annexation of the Krim Island. And on the right side, you see Google Maps Ukraine, and there we see the borders is basically stroked or somehow undefined. So here it's also quite clear that with those maps, they're making political decisions. And and here I think it's important to point out that Google is basically trying to support the local, let's say, map market in the country to not lose it, right? And therefore they have to represent the local or the country opinion where they're operating. And I think for me, the much more elegant way would be actually, if it's like an unclear situation, then, you know, make it neutral as possible in that sense, like make it stroked instead of, or let's say a stroke line for border instead of drawing a border for area, which is basically not really 100% defined when it comes to an international point of view. And Yeah, that's also maybe an interesting side fact here for this project, because this project is a bit older than the Google Maps hack. I did this in 2019. And on this web page, everything was interactable and clickable. So you could be basically, you could basically zoom in, zoom out, scroll and so on. And after I published the Google Maps hacks, the one with the smartphones, then suddenly this one was not working anymore. So that means that probably somebody at Google had a look at my web page and they checked basically the way how I somehow sneaked in into their API request, and then they blocked it. And that was also quite interesting, or quite interesting, let's say, reaction from Google developers to this project. And but also in a way, like, yeah, kind of an interesting way to see like how they interact or how the response was. And yeah, I think maybe also as a future point of view when it comes to maps is that for sure, like, we have digital maps and we know it already from the internet that, you know, once you're doing some search, for example, in a search engine like Google, you know, we're getting advertising and you know, we're getting basically, we're sharing some metadata with them and getting personalized advertisements. And of course, this will also be implemented into the future of the digital maps, especially in the future of navigation systems. And there are already some, let's say, experiments with it, which means that when I go from A to B and another person goes from A to B, obviously from the same starting point to the same destination as I do, then we probably will get different routes, because maybe we are getting different routes where we're crossing by shops or something like this that might be more interesting to our personal needs or to my personal need than to the other one. And this is, let's say one scenario where you where we probably could think about, like, could this be like a potential conflict we don't would like to go. And the other thing is that also, let's say, digital maps are also some kind of, let's say, link in between, or are being used as a link in between different, let's say, applications or let's say digital services, you know, like food delivery services, like, you know, Foodora and so on, but also of course dating services like Tinder. They are basically also using maps and these services as a platform to navigate their users. And for another example, Fox is the application which is called Pokemon Go. It was like a super huge famous, or is still like a super, super huge famous application young people play. And what happened there was that Pokemon Go basically used Google Maps to navigate their users to specific places. And on the other hand, you had players, for example, like McDonald's, and they bought in their services into the through Google Maps with Pokemon Go, and told them like, hey, maybe could you please place some, let's say, raw Pokemons in front of our stores that a lot of, you know, users or let's say young people go there to play there. And maybe they come up with the idea, you know, to get some food and then basically come into our store. And I think this is something which is a totally new, or let's say quite of a let's say challenging thing or new thing with digital maps, where well, basically discussed like how far we'd like to go there on the one hand, but also the other question for me is like, yeah, okay, how much data we're going to share with these maps, and maybe we should be thinking about data snippet you're going to share with them. Is it like this, that maybe you're going to share with them? So yeah, I think that's basically it for my end. And yeah, thank you very much.
Thank you, Simon. We had difficult to hear your last 10 words, but all the rest of presentation was good. Okay. Yeah. Okay. And my comments is that we suffer the maps in a passive way, usually, not in your approach, your artist approach. I think you give an objective vision. on which we can elaborate and think. So thank you, Simon, for to be here today, for your interesting presentation.